Hello, this is Teleosaurus again, and welcome to part 7 of my series on the evolution of muzzleloader design. Tonight, we're going to deal with the percussion locks. As you can see here, from my collection, I have 3 percussion lock muzzleloaders. 2 are civilian, and 1 is military. As I mentioned in my previous video on the flintlocks, the bottom one here is a CBA Kentucky rifle, actually the very first gun I ever owned, that was built about 30 years ago by my dad, who is still alive, thank you, 91. And this shows you, it's not as gaudy as a lot of the Kentucky or Pennsylvania style long rifles. They're really, people call them Kentucky rifles, but they're really Pennsylvania rifles. But it's kind of suits my style since I don't like gaudy guns. But it shows you a long barrel, 45 caliber. You have here a hammer and a percussion nipple, which of course you would put a percussion cap on. And you can thank the Reverend Alexander Forsyth for the invention of the percussion system in the early 1800s, 1807, if I'm mistaken. If I am wrong, I'm sorry. But it's around that time. But the percussion cap itself wasn't invented until about a little over 10 years later. And this follows the typical design of a 45 caliber, long-barreled arm that would be found in the eastern part of the United States. On ahead of this one is another civilian gun. It is typical of a half-stock rifle. This one is a 32 caliber CVA squirrel rifle that was built a couple of years later by my dad, again for me. Thank you very much. This one's a little 32 caliber. But as you can see, it's got the typical small cap nipple cone. It's got sight, rear sight, front sight. Obviously, this is not period correct. This is more of a modern style sight, but it's true to the nature of the traditional muzzleloader, which, of course, I am fully for. And then we got here the design of the military rifle musket. Now, some people call them rifled muskets, but that would be really originally a smoothbore musket that was then later rifled. So the correct term for this would be rifle musket. This is a Parker Hale Enfield P-53. 577 caliber that was used by both sides in our Civil War. Now, the difference between this one, in addition to the others, is this uses a larger cap called what we call a top hat cap. It's also got the ladder sight. And so, you can actually shoot pretty good, long range. And I'm going to show you here the designs of the different caps. As you can see, this is the top half cap, and this is the typical type number 11 cap. As you can see, the little number 11 is a lot smaller, a little bit more delicate, and a little harder to put on the cap, on the nipple. While the top half cap can be easily grabbed from a pouch and placed on the nipple like so. Of course, I'm not going to actually go to full cock and fire it because caps are corrosive. In addition, another major design difference is that the civilian guns fire round balls. This gun, the military one, was designed to fire a mini ball. Now, I took what we normally shot out of a 58 caliber gun, 577 caliber, and show you the difference on these. As you can see, this is a mini ball, and this would be the appropriate sized round ball. This particular one is a 5.62, which will be used with a patch. But as you can see, there is a big difference. It's a lot heavier. This is about a 500 grain. I gotta look this one up, but this is a lot lighter. And also ballistically, being that this is, of course, of a more pointed shape, it would travel a lot farther. Ballistically, a round ball loses a lot of energy pretty fast. After 100 yards, I mean, this thing would be traveling a lot faster than this. But these bullets, as you see, has a hollow base, because this would be rammed down without a patch. And the explosion from the black powder going off would actually force the skirt to engage the rifling and thus help with the accuracy. But since it's slightly smaller than the bore itself, you could ram it down rather easily like you can a regular musket ball. I also have a bayonet for this one, but it's pretty similar to the one from I Found Best, except that it has a locking ring. And that's about it. I don't have a percussion smooth bore, but it would generally follow the same design as the Enfield, except, of course, it wouldn't have a rear sight, and it would be generally a larger caliber, either 69 or up to 75, depending upon what country it's from. And you just go to full cock. Oh, okay. That was something you're not supposed to do, dry fire. Luckily, I kind of kept the weight on my finger, but you shouldn't do that, dry fire a nipple, because you will damage the metal. It really needs to be have a cap on it. And you can see this one's got a double trigger. And that's really about it. Thank you very much for watching my videos. I hope you found them educational. And keep the powder dry. Have a good one.